thank you tonight for your grace. Your grace is sufficient, and you're able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can think or ask. Father, we thank you. Oh, that we are what we are because of the grace of God. We thank you, Lord, for the grace of God that hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, that we can live righteously, godly, and soberly in this present world. Your grace is sufficient, and Lord, you're able to cause all grace, whatever measure we need, you're able to cause that measure of grace to abound to us so that we will have sufficiency in everything. Lord, in everything, we are enriched by you. Oh, God, you have been, hallelujah. You have, hallelujah, abounded to us in all wisdom. Yes, in all that we need, you have become our wisdom. You have become our righteousness. You have become our self, our redemption. Yes, you have become our sanctification. Oh, God, we have all that we need. All that we need is in you, Jesus. And you're able, hallelujah, hallelujah, to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can think or ask. We thank you tonight, Lord. Yes, for being in us, being for us. And if you be for us, it doesn't matter. Amen. What comes against us? Greater are you that is in us than he that is in the world. We can do all things through you. Yes, it's because of your grace, your power. We are not sufficient in ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of you. We give you praise and for glory. Hallelujah. For all things, we thank you for every good and every perfect gift. All coming from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. We are complete in you. Hey, hallelujah. Oh, God. Halamahashande. Yikiburhurabarasa. Obaraseke. Laramata. Yilabaha. Benshimindulamaha. Oh, God, you're able to keep us from falling. Able to do, hallelujah, all that you have promised to do. Every promise in you, Lord, is yea and amen. Oh, God, your promises are sure to every seed and to every generation. We thank you tonight, Lord. You always cause, hallelujah, us to triumph. You always give us the victory. You always come through. Hey, hallelujah. You are the strength of my life. You are the light of my salvation. Lord, we thank you. It's not of ourselves. Oh, God, it's not by power, not by our might, but it's by your spirit. Oh, God, we thank you for power and authority that you have given us over all power of the enemy, and nothing by no means shall hurt us. Lord, we thank you. We thank you tonight, Lord. Yes, we thank you tonight, Lord. Hallelujah. We give you the glory. We give you the praise. We delight in you. Lord, you said that we delight in you. You will give us. Hey, the desires of our hearts. Lord, you said if we delighted greatly in the word, yes, you will call riches and godly wealth to be in our homes. And yes, the seed of the upright shall be blessed. Hey, Lord, the blessings comes as we honor you. Yes, as we do what you have made us to be. Lord, you said that we are to be, hallelujah, that chosen generation to show forth that royal priesthood, that holy people called to show forth the glory of him that has brought us out of darkness. Lord, we are to offer up those spiritual sacrifices to you. Hallelujah, continually, that is the fruit of our lips. Yes, 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 giving thanks to your name. Oh, God, you delight in our sacrifices. Oh, yes, 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 we exalt you, hallelujah. Yes, in our singing, our praise, but we magnify you. without thanksgiving. Lord, we thank you tonight. We thank you tonight, Lord. Yeah, for you been this shade. You are with us. If you be for us, our strength, our help, our leader, our shepherd, our provision, our sanctification, our wisdom, all that we need is in you. Lord, we give you the praise and the glory tonight. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lord, be exalted tonight as we worship you. Hey, as we come in your presence, for in your presence there's fullness of joy at your right hand. Pleasures forevermore. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you tonight that we overcome us in this life. We rule and reign as kings and priests. Yes. Through the abundance of righteousness, the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, we reign over the flesh. Yea, the flesh shall not have dominion over us. Hey, we put on the Lord Jesus. We make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the desires of it. Hallelujah, thereof. We thank you for victory over the flesh. Hey, hallelujah. Yes, for those that are crucified. Yes, but hallelujah, those that are off you, Lord, have crucified the flesh with all of the lust. Lord, we thank you. Hey, yes, for victory over sin. Hey, yes, victory over sin, for sin shall not have dominion over us. Oh, we're not servants of sin, but servants of righteousness. And we yield not our members as instruments of hallelujah, of unrighteousness unto sin. Hey, but we yield ourselves to God. Yes, Lord, we thank you that we have the ability to walk in the Spirit. And if we walk in the Spirit, Lord, we will not fulfill the desires of our flesh. Father, we give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Victory, victory over sickness. Victory over disease. Hey, hey. We've been redeemed from every curse of the law. Satan is under our feet. The balaskar, behold, the power of Satan over us has been completely broken. Hey, he's a defeated foe. And we reign and we rule in this life. Lord, behold, Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name. We give you the praise. We give you the glory now. In Jesus' name. Everybody say in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. The name above every name. Victory, victory, victory in the name. Healing is in the name. Salvation is in no other. Strength is in the name. Lord, we thank you today. And whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For the name of the Lord is that strong tower. The righteous run therein, and they are saved. We give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody say in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Hey, la la ba ha sha. Just spend about 2 or 3 minutes praying in the Holy Ghost. You have to come and worship. Amen. Praise God without praise and worshiping Him in the Spirit. Hey, worship the Shabbat. Lord, we give in our best worship, Lord, is in the Spirit. Come and sign that. Lord, we just don't want to come and worship in ourselves. And yes, but we want to get to the end of ourselves and get, hallelujah, out of our flesh and out of our limitations and barriers and just begin to flow in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Lord, help us to be mindful of us that we are to praise you with all that we have whenever we come. Lord, things that we can't express no other way, we can express them in the Holy Ghost. And you said for us to be filled, to stay filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh God, you've done so much for us. We can't always express it in our own language. Let it be, but we can go beyond the barriers and the limitations of our language. Yes, and begin to praise you. And get renewed, get refreshed, get strengthened, get revitalized, get rejuvenated, get built up. Oh, the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, when we praise you in the beauty of holiness. Oh, it blesses. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah, shanda. Lala maho korona shanda. Inda lama ho korona shanda lama ka. Lala lehi shekele lehi kele. Lele lehi lala maho shanda lama ka shata. Oh, God, we thank you. Hey, ayalama, halama, halama, ha. And you can make intercessions for us. You can pray, hallelujah, through us. Yes, you have a way to make intercession for us. But as we pray, hey, la, 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 ha, 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 ha. As we pray in the Holy Ghost, hey, la, 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 la. As we pray in the Holy Ghost, hey, la, 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 ha, shata. As we pray in the Holy Ghost, hey, hey. The Spirit will pray, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Things we need that we can't even think of, hallelujah. Yes, blessings, that we desire, that we can express, Lord, that we can pray. We can pray in the Holy Ghost. Lord, we don't want to miss the opportunity. Hey, to touch you, Lord. Yes, to pray beyond our limitations. Hey. To pray beyond all of the barriers and hindrance, our tiredness, our weakness, our emission, our ignorance. Yes, Lord, we can go beyond that. And we can sing, sing hymns and spiritual songs. Make melody in our hearts to God. Lord, we thank you for that refreshing. We thank you for that refreshing. We thank you for the refreshing. We thank you for the refreshing of the renewal of the Holy Ghost. As we live in your mission and in King, as we love the Lord, glory to be He shaking in the oh, let me make you love the as we sing. We can finish the kilomoko finish. We can sing glory. We can make melody in our heart. Hey. Oh, hey. We can activate angels. Yes, hallelujah. Through the prayer. Hey, pray in the spirit, Lord. Can activate, hey, our ministry spirits, activate angels. Let it be put up to work, release them in the spirit, Lord, of our halamahata, to move, hey, to move, hallelujah, move in us, Hashemah, move in us, Lord, move in the meantime. When we all can live in a kilomoko raka shanda. When we lift our karamoroma kishanda mokoraha. When we lift our voices up in one accord. Hey, and let the Holy Ghost hear the whole shanda. Let the Holy Ghost hear the rinke shanda. Let the Holy Ghost have his way. Hey, yeah. Lord, we give it. We keep it in shame. Let it be love of the Holy. Let it be love of the whole Kobe. Thank you, Lord. Hey, for the victory. This is the victory that overcomes. This is the victory that overcomes. Hallelujah. We give you praise, Lord, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Father, we thank you this evening. Oh, we thank you for the spirit of rejoicing. Oh, for his joy, unspeakable and full of glory, when we worship you with the beauty of holiness. We thank you tonight, Lord. Hey, we give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Okay, I don't know whether everybody have your books. How many have your books tonight? Responsibility on our part if we go into understand the cost of knowing Christ. You know, understand the cost of knowing Christ, then we're going to cost a penny. Somebody said, Pentecost, you're going to be a Pentecost or cost a penny. Okay. But there are some ingredients very vitally needed in order for us to come up to the full measure of a true disciple, and we are trying to take you through those steps so that you can really understand that it's not just something that we just automatically adhere to, or we will automatically do the works of Jesus or follow the example, but there's a price tag behind. Amen. Knowing Christ. And I think the last chapter, the cost of knowing Christ, we talked about Paul's decision to totally submit to the will of God. Amen. We understand all of the things that Paul went through. But one thing about Paul, he was totally trusting in the Lord. I'm just going to kind of skim chapter 6. Paul's decision to totally submit to the will of God. Amen. Paul, as we know, his mind was made up initially, because when he had the experience with the Lord, he made a determination that he would count all things but loss. In other words, secondary compared to the knowledge of Christ that he sought. And he paid a price. He went through a lot of adversity, a lot of experiences. God had to do a lot of things through him, and God had to permit many things to befall him, but Paul learned the lesson, and he emerged as one of the greatest disciples, one of the greatest followers, greatest apostle of all apostles. Amen. One favorite scripture that we always refer to, Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. And nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Amen. The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Amen. But all of the deep revelations that we have in the New Testament, especially the revelations that we consider most vital, for instance, like the revelation of righteousness. Okay, who received that revelation? It was the what? Apostle Paul. Amen. That's the greatest revelation of all revelations that we read about in the New Testament. That was the reason why Paul was able to carry out the will of God and to fight the good fight of faith. And he emerged as the apostle that wrote over half of the entire New Testament. And he's the one that laid down all of the doctrine, basically, that we have, and all of the theology and the teachings that pertains to who we are in Christ. All of it practically came through the Apostle Paul. And I think that the key thing that enabled him to trust and totally depend on God and to be faithful and committed to his call, I think most of this hinged around being able to understand who he was in Christ. Amen. That was the greatest revelation. Amen. He even mentioned that we, through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, what we reign. So Paul won all of his victories. He was able to go through all that he went through, and he was able to emerge as a very powerful apostle because, amen, the revelation of who he was in Christ. And that really challenged me, and chapter 6 is a chapter that you can study for a long time because there's so many aspects of Paul's ministry conveyed in there. But I wanted to share something that I think is very key that Paul really gave us a revelation of. Amen. One thing that Paul gave us that a revelation of, and I'm going to just share this from our Salvation Holy Spirit book, that turn to this scripture, you might be able to follow me. I think I did it Sunday, because the entire realm of our teaching and what we believe hinges around our position or the righteousness. When we say righteousness of God, that means right standing. It's more or less the position that God has raised us up, amen, to be seated in, that position of righteousness or right standing. And somebody said righteousness is the ability to stand before the Lord without a sense of fear or inferiority. In other words, when you understand who you are in Christ and that Christ has elevated you, amen, and translated you out of the kingdom of darkness to this marvelous light, that you have a new position. In other words, the same position that God created man in, that's the position that we are restored back to when we receive and become the righteousness of God. And that is a very highly exalted position. Y'all heard me on Sunday, and this is found in Hebrews. It says, what is man that thou art mindful of him? Now you could translate that, this is Hebrews 1. Hebrews 2:6. But one in a certain place testified, said, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visited him? Thou madest him a little lower than the angels. And I just wanted to kind of elaborate on that because it might not be that clear. The position that you have as a believer and the extent of your dominion and the extent of your possessions that you have in Christ, blessings. Thou madest him a little lower than the angels, thou crownest him with glory and honor, and just set him over the works of thy hands. We all know that this was the position that man initially was created to have, because man was the crown of God's creation. How many can say amen? God made man to fellowship with, and there was nothing that God made on the level that he created man, because man was made for a special reason, to fellowship with God, to give him glory. Amen. How many know that we were made to praise the Lord, to glory him, and to magnify the Lord? And we, man was also created to show forth God's glory, so God could be manifested and demonstrated, and people in the world could see God through him. So he was a person that God worked through. because most people will never have a personal encounter with God. We never will see God, amen, in the flesh. But one thing about it, God can be seen through what? Through us. That's the reason the Bible says, let your light so what? Shine before men, so that what? They will see your what? Good works, and glorify me, which is in heaven. So God is seen through us being conformed to his image. And that was the purpose that God had for us initially after we fell through Adam, that man was to be created, amen, recreated in his image, because initially man was created in his image and in his likeness. And how many believe that the new creation restores all that man lost? If you, after you get saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, if you really get a revelation, that means you have to study the Word, you have to be occupy your role as a workmanship. You got to do a lot, you got to follow the example of Jesus, but if you follow the example, you will eventually end up being conformed to the image of God. Amen. When people see you, they'll see Jesus. Is that right? Amen. And you'll be so much like him if you would just consistently build the Word of God into your spirit and really consistently would glorify him and magnify him and make the way for God to do in you, amen, what he really wills to do in order for you to be, amen, all that he wants you to be. Amen. So man was crowned with glory and honor. Everybody just think about that. When the man was created, he was crowned with glory and honor. Amen. Glory and honor. You know, there's a scripture we always say, the Lord God is a sun and shield. He gives what? Grace and glory. Amen. Grace is the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ. Amen. Somebody said grace is God's unmerited what? Favor. It's all of God's love and mercy and everything that God has, amen, released toward you, making you all that you need to be. Whatever measure of grace you need, God is able to give you, to cause whatever measure of grace you need to abound toward us. Amen. But that was the way man was created. Amen. With everything that he had, everything that he needed in the natural, everything that he needed in the spiritual, right? Amen. How many can conceive of everything that man ever needed, naturally, spiritually, and in any other way, that thing was provided man through, amen, through creation. In fact, God wanted man to be what? Complete in him. He didn't want him lacking for nothing. And I can't think of anything that God had equipped man with, amen, when he was what? First placed in the Garden of Eden, when he was created. Amen. So that creation was a big thing. The scripture says man was crowned with what? Glory and honor. And God placed everything under his what? Feet, under his control, under his dominion. There's nothing that God created is on the level that he created man. Man is the sole ruler, amen, of this universe. Everything has been placed under his dominion, under his control. And if you know how to assess it, is amen. If you know how, amen, if you get that revelation, amen, and let God, amen, and establish that fellowship with him so God can, amen. The Bible says, eye hasn't seen, neither what? Ear has heard, neither has it entered into the heart of men the things that God has what? Prepared for them that what? Love him. But God has to reveal these things to us by his what? Spirit. And that's the reason why we are filled with the Holy Spirit. We're born again, recreated, amen, with that image, that likeness of God. Now, if you want to see how much we're like God, I mean, just look at the Old Testament. The covenant men of God, they were kind of like what? Amen, like Jesus was, weren't they? I mean, Moses, I mean, he stretched forth that rod and that. I mean, they were rulers. They controlled the works of God's hands. Is that right? And who was that spoke to the sun? And the Joshua spoke to the what? Sun? And told the sun what? Don't go down until we get through amen, with this victory that we are involved with. So these were men, and think about men like Daniel that was thrown in the lion's den, which the lions did not have what control over. Amen. The lions devoured all of those enemies of Daniel and their families. They were all thrown to the lions, and what? The lions had a big picnic, right? They had a good time. But the lions were not released because Daniel knew the authority that he had. Amen. As a what? Covenant son of God. You find many men of God in the Old Testament. Think about Elijah calling down fire from heaven. And these men were men that operated in a certain degree of the dominion and the power that God had initially bestowed upon what Adam. They didn't, amen, they weren't operating the fullness of it, but you can get a good glimpse of what God had in mind when he made man a little lower than angels and crowned him with what? Glory and honor. You can see it through a whole lot of the Old Testament men of what? Faith. And that's the reason we see a much fuller view of it under the new covenant under men like Paul. Amen. How many know Apostle Paul was a great man of God? Amen. Praise God. But if you want to get a perfect image, if you really want to know exactly how perfectly, how complete God made man initially, and man did a good job of blowing it. Amen. If you really want to see a good view of it, you can look at Jesus. I mean, we never think about looking at Jesus. This is the first Adam was who? The old Adam that what? That sinned. Amen. And that that brought us under the power of spiritual darkness. But the second Adam was who? Jesus. Amen. If you really want to understand exactly the glory, the dominion, the power, the degree of glory and honor that man had initially, you can look at the life of Jesus. This is how God intended for us to what? Be, if you look at the picture of Jesus. Amen. How many understand the fellowship that Jesus had with his Father? He always spent time with his Father, and his Father always revealed to him exactly what he needed, what he wanted him to do. The words that he spoke, they were not what? His words. The miracles that he performed, amen, and the doctrines that he received, none of that was attributed to him. Jesus did not attribute none of that to him. But he got it through fellowship. So man was made to fellowship with God. Is that right? And this is the initial man that God is speaking about. God, he made him a little lower than the angels and crowned him with glory and honor. Amen. How many understand the ministry of Jesus? What did he have power and control over, dominion over? I mean, just name some of the things that Jesus reigned over. He ruled everything, amen, that God had placed under his dominion. He ruled it. What did he rule? Something, amen. Name some of the things that he ruled. Yeah, he ruled the forces of nature. So, amen, the dominion of man, amen, actually controls the forces of nature. But we never would think about the forces of nature. Amen. How many would believe that we have power over death? Amen. How many remember the old mothers and people that really understood, amen, who they were in Christ, and people that worshiped God? Amen. Praise God for years, that prayed in the Spirit, that did the works of Jesus. They gave their lives, amen, for the sake of the gospel. Amen. Many of them were what? Long livers. How many can say amen? And when death came for them, what did they say? Amen. They have to give death permission to take them. I mean, they did. They had power. And how many remember, you heard about old saints, how many of them prayed for people that were dead, and God restored them back to life. Amen. We see that in the ministry of Jesus. We see that in the ministry of who? That Peter? Is that right? Amen. And all over the Bible, we see people being raised from the dead. So, We have power over the laws of nature, but we don't see ourselves as, amen, as possessing the dominion over the works of God's hand. Everything that God has created, we have dominion over. Amen. Let me just go over this. Here's some of the ways that angels and man compare. Amen. Temporarily, man was made inferior to angels. But the Bible says God made man a little lower than angels. And even Jesus himself, amen, for the suffering of death, he was made what? Lower than angels. But I'm going to show you, amen, what that referred to. Angels excel man in strength. Physically, angels are not limited by time, space, and matter. They are subject to death. They transcend laws of creation by traveling at the speed of thought, appear and disappear. So when it comes to man made inferior to angels, when it comes to man's temporal position in terms of physical strength, in terms of not being subject to death, also, they transcend laws of creation by traveling at the speed of thought. When you think about man being able to compare with angels in that respect, in terms of strength, physically, man is not, he's inferior to angels. And Jesus was also inferior to angels in that respect because he was just limited in what? Strength. And he didn't have the power of angels because he was made like what man, so he could become subject to what? Death. Amen. So that he could what? Become sin for us. So he had to be made lower than angels for the suffering of death. But that was temporarily. Amen. Praise God. So angels, now some of the ways, now I'm going to show you how man is superior to angels. Amen. How many believe that you are superior to angels in some area? All right. All right. So, but when it comes to physically, when it comes to being able to what? To go across the universe in a split second, how many can appear and disappear? We can't do that, right? We ain't equal to angels in that respect. All right, we're not subject to, but we are, angels are not subject to death, so angels got it on you because they don't have to die. Amen. Also, angels have passed their probation and they're perfected and they're beyond the possibility of rebellion and sin. So these are some of the ways that angels outstrip us. Amen. You understand that? See, the Bible says man was what? Created a little what? Lower than angels. So, man was created slightly inferior to God. Amen. Slightly inferior to God because God, you know, he has all of these qualities that we don't have. God don't die, right? God is not, amen, he doesn't have to deal with no probation or sin or nothing like that. All right, but when it comes to position, this is what we're speaking about. When it comes to temporal things, we are inferior to angels. So we don't want to feel that we, you know, we are not about nothing. But on the other hand, when it comes to our position in God, we were created superior to angels as well as the laws of creation. Amen. Man was created as sons positionally, not servants. And man was created to rule and not to be ruled or to be subject of any being except God. That's good news. Amen. Man was the only thing that God created. Amen. That was created superior to everything else that God had created. Amen. So man was made to what? Rule and not to be ruled. Okay, so that's good news because that's what it means when man was created and God made him a little lower than angels, crowned him with what? Glory and honor, and did set him over the works of thy hands. That was the initial way that man was what? Created. But what is the difference between the way man was created and the way man was recreated? Okay, does he still possess those same abilities and qualities, amen, that man had when he was created, amen, praise God, from the beginning? Does the recreation restore him back to favor? Back to his position? Okay, so position-wise, when we said position-wise, man was restored back to his original position. I want you to just say that. Amen. I've been restored back to my original position in Christ. Amen. Just like I was created, man was created initially, he was the crown of God's creation. Everything that God created was what? Subject to man. Though every law that God created, man was what? Amen. Man, what? He was superior to it, right? He had dominion. He had control. He had power over every law. And see, right now, I'm going to ask y'all this question. Do we have power over the laws of creation? If that's the way we started out as men, as man, we had, the power over what? Everything that God had what created. But do we have power over all of the things that God has created now? Or was that just under Adam? Okay. Now, see, I think that the key to understanding our position better is to the chapter that we studied. We saw Jesus doing all of these things, and he did none of them in the strength of his own what? Ability. Is that right? So he laid aside all of the things that what would categorize him as what? God, being, you know, doing them through, amen, as God, so that we could, amen, see that when we, amen, are born again and when we become like Christ, amen, we need to understand that we begin to operate in the same dominion, all right, the same position. All right, but many times we can't see anything but salvation. You know, we see, we get salvation, we get what, the Holy Ghost, but we don't see no dominion, we don't see no rulership, we don't see no what? Amen. All of the other benefits, which are what? Numerous. We don't see all of that, but we only see ourselves as what? Just a sinner saved by what? Grace. Amen. So Jesus, if we understood everything that Jesus did, amen, that was to show us that we can do all of the things that he did, and the works that he did, he can do works, we can do works that are greater, because that dominion, that position, amen, that man started out, man was made lower than angels, but he was what? Crowned with what? Glory and honor, and God placed what? All things under his feet. He was slightly inferior to God, when it comes to the respect of operating, amen, in the natural. But when it comes to operating in the spiritual, amen, man has been restored back, and he was created superior to angels. And position-wise, we're not servants. We were created to rule and not to be ruled. Amen. Or to be subject of any being except what? God. Amen. All right, now, how many can say we are not subject to any? Our flesh. Amen. That's what the Bible is trying to teach us, that what? We are not debtors to our flesh to live after the flesh. See, we've been elevated to a what? Amen. To that original place in God. Thereby that position, which is described in many passages in the New Testament. Amen. Now, let me show you one place where your position is described. Amen. And if this would ever dawn on us, that how that we have rulership over the flesh, we have rulership over sin, we have rulership over all of the forces of darkness. Sometimes, amen, it seems like we don't have nothing, we don't have nothing going, but we just need to what? Thoroughly understand what it means to be what? Recreated, and to be recreated in the image of God. Amen. The Bible says God predestined, amen, even from the beginning, that we would be conformed to his image. So that the image that was lost to Adam, has been what? Regained through who? Jesus. Amen. That all the physical benefits and spiritual benefits, all of the things that pertains to life and godliness, every blessing in heavenly places, and everything that was operating in the life of Jesus. That's the easiest way to understand the extent of your dominion, is just to see, just to understand all of the different things that were operating through Jesus. If you could go through the four Gospels and the book of Acts and just see what was operating through Jesus and the apostles, all of these things have been what? Restored to us as believers. Amen. That's the message that Paul is trying to get over to us in the New Testament. Amen. And that requires a revelation. You have to get a revelation. You have to pray that the eyes of your understanding might be what? Enlightened. Amen. Because these things are spiritually discerned. The average person ain't going to believe that he, amen, has the same position. God loves me as much as he loved Jesus. That I'm an heir of God and I'm joint heir of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. And he that sanctified and those that are sanctified are all of one. And he's not ashamed to call them what? Brethren? How many know that Jesus is our brother? No, you're right. I ain't getting the two amens on that. Amen. But we put Jesus way out there, and we just a little old peon. We struggling and barely up and down. Amen. So we need to, amen, keep these realities kind of fresh in our mind. Okay, I want you to look at Ephesians 2. I'm going to show you 2:4. But God, who is rich in mercy, talks about you have he quickened. I'll just read the whole thing. You have he quickened. Who were dead in trespasses and sin. Quicken means to be made alive. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in what? Mercy, for his great love, wherewith he what? Loved us. Even when we were what? Dead in sins, hath what? Quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are what? Saved. And hath what? Raised us up together, and made us what? Sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Jesus Christ. That sounds like the glory and that honor that we lost through Adam has been what? Restored when we were quickened together and we were made alive. And not only were we quickened, amen, together with Christ, but we were raised up together with him, made us to what? Sit in what? Heavenly places. Amen. So we've been elevated to the same, you know, the level, the same position that we lost through Adam, and we regained it through Christ, and we are seated with him. Amen. We're seated with him in heavenly places. That means that we share in all of the glory, in all of the power, in all of the honor, in everything that Jesus operated in when he was down here how many years were that? 30? Amen. But actually his ministry was about 3.5 years. But everything that Jesus was, everything that he did during those 3.5 years, amen, that's the level that God wants us to operate on. And there's no way we're going to come close to it unless we get a revelation. Amen. Praise God. That's the reason why we start with, amen, glorifying God and praising God. And amen. So some things will begin to open up to us. Amen. If we open up and praise God, then God will begin to what kind of show us. Amen. Okay, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast, for we are his workmanship. Now how could, created in Christ Jesus, unto what? Good works, which God hath before ordained that we should what? Walk in them. So we have been restored back to the position that we started out with under Adam. It was restored under Christ. And we, amen, can actually be conformed to the image of Christ as we begin to build the Word of God into us and begin to follow the example that Jesus, amen, gave us. Jesus said that greater works And these shall ye do. Amen. Because I go to my Father. Now let me just finish that. My time is up. Angels and powers have been made subject to Christ. Amen. The same has been made subject to believers through the name of Jesus. Now, let me show you, amen, that angels and authorities and powers have been made subject to Christ. Okay, whatever has been made subject to Christ, amen, has been made subject to what? Us. Because all of the authority and all that Christ regained and took back from the devil and, amen, from that lost dominion, that was reserved for what? All of those that became partakers of his nature. Amen. So everything that Christ recaptured through his death, amen, burial and resurrection, that power and authority, I mean, that's dominion, that's all of the Bible says, the heirship and the rulership, priesthood, the ability to come before the presence of God, amen. All of those things that were reestablished through Christ, those things have become, amen, things that we have begun to be, that we are partakers of. Amen. The scripture says, as he is, so are we in this world. So as he is, so are we. Now, angels are subject to Christ, then angels are subject to us. And we know that because you all know the scripture better than I do, that angels hearken to the voice of what? Our commands. How many have ever heard that before? Jesus even said that, I don't think I can bring down 12 legions of angels when they came to what? To capture him. Jesus said, well, angels are still, I can call 12 legions if I want to. Amen. So if Jesus can call 12 legions, we ought to be able to call what? One, at least one angel, right? But angels are subject to us. Amen. Praise God. How many can say amen? And principalities. Principalities are high-ranking demonic forces. Amen. Amen. How many can say amen? Okay, another scripture you can look at, we which have received abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign. What does that mean? We which have received abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. In other words, if you've been restored back to your position as a believer through Christ, if you have received abundance of grace, we just have to read it, by grace are you what? Saved through faith. That's not of ourselves, it's the what? Gift of God. How many believe that we got an abundance of grace? God don't limit his grace toward us, right? He's, amen. The Bible says he's crowned us with what? Glory and what? Honor. And has put what? All things under our what? Feet. How many believe that includes Satan?
Amen.
Does it? Does it? All right. How many can say I'm crowned with glory and honor? And I'm seated with him. In other words, you pass from the old kingdom, right, of inferior, kingdom of weakness, kingdom of what? Kingdom of what? Weakness, inferiority, kingdom of unworthiness, kingdom of, amen, praise God, poor self-image, and don't think nothing of yourself, don't believe you ain't no count, born to lose. You've been translated from that kingdom to the kingdom of what? His dear Son. So that means that there's a change of position. You were a servant of sin, but now you're a servant of what? Righteousness. And you're seated with him in heavenly places. Now we have received abundance of grace. I want you to just say that with me. I receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. And I reign in this life through Jesus Christ. In other words, your rulership and your ability to control and to dominate and to rule and to cause everything to be subject to us, it comes through what? The abundance of grace. It's not of yourselves. Our sufficiency is not of our what? Selves. Our sufficiency is of what? God. So God is what? He just, amen, abounding toward you in whatever measure, however, whatever measure you can believe him to be, that's the measure he's going to what? He's going to what? He's going to release toward you. Amen. We receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. That shows that we are rulers and we are, amen, have been translated from the kingdom of darkness. Amen. And rulership, amen, that position means that heirship, amen, it means that all things have been restored back to you. Everybody say, all things are mine. Amen. Y'all don't believe that. Amen. You have to make yourself believe some of this stuff, right? You have to what? Keep saying it until it becomes what? You get comfortable. How many know you just don't get comfortable with everything you are in Christ overnight, right? You have to work with it. Sometimes you have to go through a little something, right? And then God can just show you what who he is and what he has what bestowed upon you. And you can see that you have more grace than you even what ever thought you had. Because God's grace is always going to prove to be what? Sufficient. Amen. Praise God. All right. Now, angels are ministering spirits. That means angels are what? Servants. They're sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation. So we can see that we reign over angels, and angels are at our command. And we were made lower than angels in the natural, but when it comes to our position in Christ, amen, we are superior to angels, and angels are at our command, and we command angels by coming into agreement with God's word. Is that right? When we speak God's word, angels begin to look. They begin to hearken. Is that right? That's the reason why the entire plan of salvation is contingent upon, amen, agreeing with whatever God says about you. See, without the realities of, amen, of the new creation and all of the things that Christ has provided through his death and resurrection, without confessing that and without knowing that, then you have what? You have no grounds to stand on. Amen. So whatever reality is in this word, amen, we need to know about it. Is that right? Because if we hook up with it, if we would come into agreement with it and begin to what? Say it, begin to what? Begin to confess it. Amen. Sometimes you have to roll these things around in your mind for a long time. Is that right?
Yes.
Amen. So but the word of God, if you program it in, amen, praise God. Someone said that if you feed your heart the word when you don't need it, then your heart will feed your what? Mouth faith. If you feed your heart faith when you don't need it, how many can say amen? Then your heart will feed your what? Mouth faith when what? You do need it. Is that right? Because sometimes out of your mouth, how many know sometimes doubt can, amen, can form in your mind? Amen. How many other ones had doubt? I mean, these words of the Bible, I mean, says one thing, but your mind is saying what? It's going a different direction, right? Amen. But one thing good about it, when faith is in your heart, faith in your heart will work when doubt is in your mind. Because the word will always what? Eradicate doubt if you come into agreement with it. And when you begin to what? Praise God and thank God for the reality of the word of God. Amen. But we want to make sure that, amen, that we understand that we are above angels. We are above all creation. We are above all of the works of God's hands. And whatever you're dealing with, if it's a part of creation, God has given you what? Dominion over it. And so the Bible says that we can what? Lay hands on the sick and the sick will recover. Take up serpents and they won't what? Hurt you. How many believe that we got power, amen, and dominion over serpents? Y'all, amen. So say your light held their hand down. I don't mess with them serpents. Amen. One thing I got to get Andrew over in the bathroom. Amen. I just can't stand, like chickens and birds and things like that. Man, you can get a bird, a chicken, a little bit of chicken or something like that. I just don't have nothing to do. Amen. Praise God. Yeah, although I have dominion, but I have to what? Apply it, and I have to begin to what? Make confession. That no weapon formed against me, by whatever I need. Amen. I got power and authority over all the works of God's hand. That's all you need. I got power and authority over all of the works of God's hand.
And if we're talking away from, don't pick up that dead bird. Yes, and I can pick up the dead birds that fall dead in the church. Yes, sometimes we have dead birds in the church. And call the brother away then. Oh, okay, but I, okay, all right. All right, praise God. So that was enough. That's enough. All right, so position-wise, we've been restored back. That means we have rulership. We have rulership over all of them. All of creation. Everybody say all of creation.
Okay, I didn't hear that, Pastor, for real. But my dad, when I'm in the house to kill the rats and the spiders, and I see the snake around the stool one day, and I say, oh my God,
wow.
I get this out. I would have sprayed it with gross stuff, and it just wiggled all up.
Where did it go?
I got it. I said, because I don't let nothing get out of my sack, because I don't know where it might go, so I'm going to beat it down.
You actually killed it?
Oh, yeah, and put it in the stool and
place it down. All right.
But you have to. You have to say, God, help me. I said, I got to do it. She was looking for the move. Mice run out of the room. She brought. I said, you don't want to run. You got to get it.
All right. If it's God's creation, you got to make it over. Circumstances, situations, even that the devil brings. We got what? Power and authority over all power of the what? Enemy. Not only over creation, but we got power over all of the what? Power of the enemy. And nothing. All right. Now, one thing I'm going to mention, I'm through. If you have been elevated back to that position, that all things are yours, that means that we got to work on the finance area, because the scripture says all things, but we have to come into agreement with the principles and the rules that you have to play by in order for those finances to come in your possession. Is that right?
Yes.
And also we have unlimited access into God's presence. Amen. We got priesthood and we have heirship. Those two things always come with your restored position. Your rulership, heirship, and priesthood. Everybody just said that. Rulership. Heirship, that means all things are yours. That means we shouldn't have any poor folk, no broke folk, people that can't do this, can't do that. But you have to come into the knowledge of all of the what scriptures that you have to be knowledgeable of in order for those things to become reality. And presence, amen, you have unlimited access into God's what presence. Amen. You don't have to get somebody to pray for you. Amen. You can come into God's presence just like everybody. All right, everybody stand. All right, Sister Pearl. All right, you can come.